really is not really that important. The truth is, I miss you guys. I miss this place. And we both did. And we're both glad we're back. We, you know, had a grandbaby born while we were gone. You may have heard about that. Our baby had a baby. So that was exciting on August 12th. But I was happy to come back because I'm coming back and it's Christmas.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I picked Christmas stuff for our service. At the 8 o'clock, more traditional. It was just a joy to have. And I just want to say, you know, that was really special. And we've done some of the same things here as far as of songs and settings as well. But what I wanted to do is just welcome all of you here, have a prayer, and then kind of set the theme. And so I've chosen Isaiah chapter 60 as a theme setting verse today, which you've heard it before, but it's usually around Christmas time. And so I'm going to be reading that. I have Julie in the back standing. Are you hanging for a reason? Oh, okay. I don't see her here yet. I don't know. Yeah, I was looking for her too.
I'm a stalker.
We have a returning baby coming to our church, I think. We're excited about that. In the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, I thank you, Heavenly Father, that you brought us again to this beautiful day, this place. You're reminding us that so many things have had to take place before you came down and lived among us as Emmanuel, God of the fruition and the fulfillment of prophecies take place. Bless us in our hearing. Bless our walks of faith. Continue to watch over our families and friends and continue to build up your people of God here in this place and throughout the world. In Jesus' name, amen. So it's from Isaiah chapter 61 through 6. So it's not a lot, but it talks about the light coming into the world that was a dark world. And I'm gonna, if you want to follow along, you have the Bible reading, or you can follow along up top. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord rises upon you. See, darkness covers the earth, a thick darkness is over the peoples, but the Lord rises upon you, and his glory appears over you. Nations will come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. Lift up your eyes and look about you. All assemble and come to you. Your sons come from afar, and your daughters are carried on the arm. Then you will look and be radiant. Your heart will throb and swell with joy. The wealth on the seas will be brought to you. To you the riches of the nations will come. Herds of camels will cover your land. Young camels of Midian and Ephah. And now we have that idea of what happened in the Bethlehem. And all from Sheba will come, bearing gold and incense, and proclaiming the praise of the Lord. And we have the Lord coming down upon us. Our opening song is Emmanuel, Hallowed Ground. Lord, long ago you spoke through the voices of men to proclaim your promise. Now you've spoken through your Son, the Word made flesh. Give us ears to hear and hearts to believe the living voice that bestows upon us the fullness of your promise once and for all. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives in unity with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. So our Bible reading for today's message, you may think, well, it's got to be Luke 2, because that's the story of Jesus' birth, but actually it's not. Most of us know the story of how the angel came to Mary and how she, you know, God was incarnate in Mary and she conceived and had this wonderful baby born and the father. And we know that story really well, and that's the ribbon that's going to run through today. But it's actually this passage from John. If you have your Bibles, I'd love you to have them ready and open. I mean, I'm going to read from the screen right now, but John chapter 1, it is packed full of just wonderful truths about God and his promise, and the God that John wanted us and all of his readers to hear. It's about the Word that's made flesh and dwelt among us. Following that, we would normally have our children's message, and I don't see any children today. So we'll go from the gospel straight to God with us, the song, just to let the band know what's going on here. So in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him. And without him, not anything was made that was made. So without Jesus, the Son of God, nothing was made that was made. This was a Trinitarian kind of process in the very beginning. It goes on in verse 4 saying, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to bear witness about the light, that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came to bear witness about the light. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. John's purpose was to make sure that people knew about the light that was coming. It's the same purpose you and I have, really. It goes on to say, he came to his own, and his own people did not know him or did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We have seen his glory as of the only Son of the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness about him and cried out, this was he of whom I said, he who comes after me ranks before me because he was before me. For from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, the only God who is at the Father's side. He has made him known. And, you know, one person hypothesized about the lineage and what's happened. I mean, you look on the walls, you can see that we've been really moving through the Bible. I mean, we're at chapter 22, which kind of transfers over to the other side of creation and the fall and the giving of the Ten Commandments and the Jericho story and King David, and it just goes on and on. One scholar hypothesized that actually you may think that all of these things were building up so that Jesus would come. And he hypothesized that actually because Jesus was planning on coming, all those things had to happen. In other words, it was out of the timeline that you and I are used to thinking. God was coming. Moses, David, all those things. Now because Jesus is coming. Martin Luther said, the Bible is the cradle, you know, that holds the baby Jesus. And so what a neat thought that is for each and every one of us to think about how God continues to work through us. He is God with us, and that's our song for today's message.
Who are we to be that you would be mine?
Well, as I mentioned earlier, we've gone through 22 chapters, and today in today's video that's going to bring us up to speed goes through those. It's a bit longer, which means I either have to talk faster or less in order for us to try to keep this confined. I did okay, I think, at the first service. No complaints there. But someone said, you know, repetition is the mother of all learning, and I truly believe that. In fact, I was listening to a comedian on the podcast as I was driving back from seeing our grandbaby, and he was saying that he was from Tennessee, someplace in Tennessee, and he said, yeah, my zip code is 37138. You know, there's a comedian who's waiting for the punchline. What in the world is he talking about? He says, well, they taught us how to remember that, because 37 plus 1 is 38. And people kind of chuckled, you know, I'm like, okay. Well, I'm telling you that. I only heard it one time, and now I've repeated it twice. My hope is that as you go through this story rewind, that you'll get a concept of how the Bible flows. And then that brings us to intertestamental time, and I'm not going to talk a lot about the 400 years that it brings us to today. So let's go ahead with that the video now.
In the beginning, God created the universe and a planet called Earth. Humans were formed in God's image to continue God's work. But soon, humans decided we want to live our way, not God's. Selfishness and violence filled the world. So God started over with just one family. And God made a covenant with a man named Abraham. The land around you is now yours. Your family will be my blessing to the entire world. In just a few generations, they grew into a large nation named Israel. The Egyptians became fearful and forced the Israelites to be their slaves. Through a humble leader named Moses, God led the Israelites in a great exodus back toward their promised land. Along the journey, God gave laws and commands to help the Israelites follow God's ways. Finally, after 40 years of struggle and complaining in the desert, the Israelites arrived back home in the promised land. In victory, the people worshiped God, but soon after, they turned from God and lived their own rebellious ways. This became a pattern from generation to generation. Israel's greatest judge was Samuel. He followed God's ways and spoke for God as a prophet. He told Israel that God was the only king they ever needed. But they desired to be like the corrupt nations surrounding them and insisted, we want a human king who we can see to rule over us just like the other nations. So Samuel found a man named Saul to be Israel's first king. His reign began well, but before long, Saul stopped following God's ways and made many bad decisions. So Samuel told Saul, because you have turned your back on God, God has rejected you as a king. Samuel's search for the next king led to a courageous young shepherd boy named David. When David grew up to be king, God blessed him and the Israelites greatly. But David was not perfect. He had an affair with a married woman and committed a murder to cover it up. But deep inside, David always loved God and would return to living in God's ways. Known as the poet warden, he wrote music to God called Psalms, heartfelt expressions of prayer, struggle, and thankfulness. After many years as king, David gave the throne to his son Solomon. God also told David, one day, one of your descendants will rule with a kingdom that will never end. Solomon succeeded his father David, becoming the richest king in Israel's history. Full of God's wisdom, Solomon wrote books like Proverbs and built a magnificent temple, a permanent tabernacle reminding people of God's continual presence. But Solomon strayed from God, marrying corrupt wives who led him into worshiping false gods. Civil war broke out, dividing the country into a northern kingdom called Israel and a southern kingdom called Judah. Soon, both of these kingdoms were led by corrupt kings who ignored God's ways. During this time, prophets were sent as messengers, calling the Israelites to return to God. They warned of the destructive consequences ahead. The prophet Elijah, a wild and rugged man, showed up false prophets by calling on God to give an awesome display of fire. The prophet Elisha followed him, bringing a boy back to life by causing him to sneeze. These prophets challenged the Israelites and their kings to return to God's better ways. But the Israelites would not listen. Distracted in their own rebellion, other nations swept in and conquered both of the kingdoms of Israel and Judah. God's people were forced out of the promised land, and many were taken away to be slaves once again. The temple was destroyed, and the people lost everything. This was a time called the Exile, where many of the Israelites, now called Jews, were scattered across different lands. One prophet named Daniel was sent to a city named Babylon. The law demanded that everyone pray only to the king of Babylon, but Daniel refused and prayed to God 3 times a day. So Daniel was thrown into a pit of hungry lions. But God closed the mouths of the lions, and Daniel emerged the next morning without a scratch. Though scattered, God was still watching over the Jewish people, and God gave them hope, speaking through the prophet Jeremiah's words, "I'll make a new covenant with the people of Israel, returning them to the promised land and filling their hearts and minds with my ways." 60 years later, this hope was realized. The Persian Empire freed the Jewish people to return to their promised land. A small number gathered back in the capital city of Jerusalem, and a new, smaller temple was built under the leadership of Ezra. Reunited, they celebrated and shouted with joy. But the elders wept in remembrance of what was lost. Prophets like Malachi and Isaiah pointed to the future and a coming king, a Messiah, one who would fully restore Israel and bring a new kingdom of peace. So the Jewish people waited and hoped, and God would not speak through the prophets again for 400 years.
It had been 400 years since God had spoken directly to the Israelites. Then, one day, God sent an angel to a girl named Mary, who was engaged to a man named Joseph. The angel told Mary that she would soon become pregnant and give birth to a son named Jesus. God would give him the throne of his ancestor David, and his kingdom would never end. But Mary was a virgin, and this confused her. So the angel told her it would be by God's power that she became pregnant. When Mary's fiancé Joseph heard about this, he decided he would quietly end the engagement. But an angel visited Joseph as well, telling him not to be afraid and that Jesus would save people from their sins. So Joseph and Mary decided to get married. Soon after, they traveled to the town of Bethlehem. Because so many other people were in town, there was no place for them to stay. While they were there, Mary gave birth to her son, wrapped him in cloths, and laid him in the manger. There were shepherds living in the fields nearby. While they were watching their sheep, an angel appeared to them, announcing that a boy had been born in Bethlehem. This boy, said the angel, was the Messiah, the king that the Israelites had been waiting for. So the shepherds left their sheep and raced to Bethlehem, finding Mary and Joseph and Jesus. The shepherds praised God for their new king. During this time, the country of Rome controlled all of Israel. After hearing about Jesus' birth, a group of magicians and astrologers came to Herod, a governor working for the Roman Empire. They claimed that they had seen a star in the sky, telling them that the king of the Israelites, now called Jews, had been born. This news really upset Herod. When they arrived in Bethlehem and met Mary, Joseph, and Jesus, they felt great joy. Herod was furious and commanded that all boys in Bethlehem who were 2 years old and younger be killed. But God had already warned Joseph, who by that time had moved his family to Egypt to hide. Later, after King Herod died, Joseph, Mary, and Jesus moved back to Israel, to a small town named Nazareth. They stayed in Nazareth for years, raising Jesus. When he was 12, they traveled to Jerusalem for a festival. When the festival ended, Joseph and Mary left for home with a large group of people, but Jesus stayed behind without them knowing. When they realized he was missing, they went back to Jerusalem and found Jesus sitting in the temple, listening to the teachers and asking them questions. His parents were upset and couldn't understand why he had stayed behind. Jesus told them, "Didn't you know I had to be in my Father's house?" Joseph and Mary didn't know what he meant. They did not yet fully understand the importance of who Jesus was and all he would do.
So as I said, the Bible reading, the text for today is in John 1, and you'll find that I will be hitting on it throughout the message, and you're a highlighter or you're a note taker, you're more welcome to go ahead and follow along as we do that. Yeah, I was talking with my son this weekend, actually just yesterday, and we had this long discussion. It was really neat because I call it geeking out together. We were talking theology and doctrine and asking questions, and it was really neat to be able to do that. And one of the things we agreed on is you need to get to the basic, the foundation of something, because then the rest of the story, the rest of all the premises and your discussion will always fall back on something that's solid. It's sort of like when you're talking to someone about the Bible and you ask them, what is it to you? And they say, well, there's God's word in there, but there's a lot of other stuff. You know, if I were to talk to someone like that and we were to talk about the Bible, we'd never agree completely, because I believe it's the real word of God, inerrant, the way it is. God's speaking through it. There's really no man stuff in there other than he used men to write it. So it's the foundation that based on it. So today we're going to be talking about the John passage and Christmas. So Merry Christmas in August. So he walked with Adam and Eve in the garden. He spoke to Moses through the fire in the burning bush. He guided Israel by the cloud in day and the fire by night. He sat enthroned over the Ark of the Covenant in the tabernacle of the temple. But all these were just a warm-up to the main event. This is the story. Now the Lord, Yahweh, would himself come, fully God and fully man. And the manner of his coming couldn't have been more amazing or unlikely. The creator of the universe, the developer of everything, the mind behind all of these things, comes from conception to a tiny embryo, to a fetus, to a newborn baby, passes through the birth canal, takes his first breaths of a smelly air of an animal stable. His mother and his adopted father, Joseph, they welcome him with joy and trepidation. This doctrine of the incarnation, of the eternal God, entering the limitations of time and space, and being born a human being, this doctrine really lies at the heart of our Christian faith. While every other religion welcomes truth-sayers, moral teachers, angelic messengers, we worship a God-man. And what can only be described as mind-bending mystery, this God-man, this child was born in a manger. And this child is known as Jesus Christ. One person with two natures, fully human, fully divine. And while many things that Jesus said revealed God in a way that no one else would and no one else could, the Word himself was his full revelation. Paul wrote in Colossians chapter 1, verses 15, 17, "The Son is the image of the invisible God. He is before all things. In him all things hold together." Now, I love that picture up there, just that Son of God, Son of Man, that concept that he holds the image of the eternal, immortal, all-powerful God, and he comes down to us. And all of this happened. All of life happened. All the prophecies happened so that he could come. Now, Christ has been as long as God has been. In fact, Jesus was the Genesis Word. How did God create the universe? He created it with his Word. Let there be, and there was. And John, in our text today in John 1, he's saying that this was the voice that said, let there be. The voice of Jesus speaking. Paul would later talk about being the firstborn of all creation. Peter would agree by saying that God chose for this very purpose before the world began. Now, it would be easy to go on a tangent. The concept of knowing something before the world began was going to happen, and then making it happen, is simply amazing. I was recently reading a book, and in that book, it was a biography, and there was a ribbon that seems to find itself in a lot of the letters that are being revealed, and that was, God's working his purpose. And he chooses to work through you and I. We are to be doers, but we're not always responsible for the outcome. You know, I can say, Jesus is the light of the world, and I believe it with all my heart. And it may or may not impact you, but that's the Spirit's job to do it. God is working, and God was working long before the world began to make it so Jesus would come. And all the writers agree about something, and that was Jesus' time that we see in the manger wasn't his first blush with the earth. It wasn't Bethlehem. Think about it. Was that Jesus wrestling with Jacob in the mud of Jabbok? Was that Jesus when Joshua was near Jericho and he fell on his face and he worshiped the one who called himself the commander of the armies of the Lord? Was that Jesus? Was that Jesus when Abraham offers to a particular mysterious priest, Melchizedek, a sacrifice and offering? And the fourth person in the fiery furnace with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, was that Jesus? Oh, man. Jesus was with Abraham. He was with Jacob. He was with Joshua. He was with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And in this chapter, we're going to see how Jesus has arranged history and events in this story to prepare for the coming. Centuries earlier, prophecies were being proclaimed. Angels were making announcements. Shepherds were touching the hem of eternity. Kings were shaking with fear in their boots. And from this point forward, everyone, when Jesus would come, would be asking one question. See, we know the answer to it. But they would be asking this question. Who is this man? And John wanted us to know. He took great care in saying Jesus is the Word, who the Word was God. He's the Word made flesh. He used that word, the Logos, the proper philosophical concept when we see this. And John was saying, I know my audience, I'm going to target them. They know about the Word. They know how it's active. They know how it has power. And I'm going to identify and show them that God and Jesus and Jesus and God and this whole concept of Word are intertwined throughout eternity. So to call God the Word was, or call Jesus the Word was equivalent to calling him God. And he also wanted the people to know that he was, this coming of the Word, Jesus Christ, was part of a larger story. See, creation, God himself enters human history. He comes into our world, something that has never happened before, something that hasn't happened since the beginning of time. And John wants his readers and you and I to examine everything that Jesus said, everything that he did. And so, like a light in a dark room, we see the Word that comes and it gives light. You know, we hear about the light of the world, Emmanuel, God with us. And we're like, okay. Every Christmas is the same thing. A little town of Bethlehem, away in the manger, silent night. Call my faithful. We got this. But the fact that the God of the universe did this. Now, as we've been talking about this upper story, lower story stuff, it really comes to a climax. It's God's upper story desires that we are his people always. He says in after creation and after the fall that there'll be a bruising and a crushing, and there's going to be pain, and there's going to be suffering, and there's going to be someone that's going to come and going to create a bridge, a bond, and it's going to happen. And throughout all history, we're waiting for this whole thing to happen. And then it happens. And how does he come? He comes as a humble Jesus. And what does that mean? Have you ever asked yourself, why humble? And there's been some sermons said on that. Some writers have written on that. The maker of the universe, the one who invented time, the one who gave you breath, the breath you just took, the one who owns everything. He started off, how humble? How humble did he start off? Well, this is how humble he started off. He's humble enough to understand what you've been through this week. He's humble to understand why it was that you were crying out to him, maybe last night or the night before, why you lost sleep. He's humble enough to know what it's like in your situation. He's humble enough to be able to answer this person who's on their knees, and whether it's in a first world or third world country, who's crying out to God because they don't have something, they're looking for mercy. He's humble enough to understand and empathize with that. You know the difference between empathy and sympathy, right? I can sympathize with someone perhaps that has lost everything, but I have not lost everything. I can empathize with someone who perhaps has lost a father because I've lost a father. In other words, empathy is something that you've experienced yourself in some way, shape, or form. Jesus can empathize. That's the humility that he has. You see, God is so humble, he doesn't come and see what's going on in your life and kind of shake his head and say, well, would you just get your act together? Pull up yourselves on your bootstraps and move on with life. No, he remembers the hungry belly. He remembers the chill of the cold. He remembers what it's like to have loss. He remembers what it's like to experience someone that he loves to die. He knows what sickness is. He knows what it's like to hear his parents tell a story about the day that they got turned away and all they were looking for was a room and an inn so he could be born in a nice, safe place. And then we live in this world and we say, well, all right, I get that. That's beautiful. The humble God, he's all powerful, and yet he comes down into my life, but my life's busy. This world is busy. In fact, I want to take my humbleness to a new level, and I want to say, maybe I'm not worthy of him coming into my life. Because the world is crowded with headlines and deadlines and long lines. People are concerned with waistlines and schedules and itineraries full of responsibilities, and we have anxiety, don't we? And Christ comes in the midst of our world and he knocks on our door and he wants to be part of our lives. And a lot of times in the world today, the response is, I'm sorry, I don't have time. It's just one more thing to complicate my life. And he doesn't come to complicate our lives. He comes to simplify our lives. The presence of God does not create complications. The presence of God clears them up. The world may be telling people, hey, my life is just too crowded. We have people that we know today say, my life is so busy, I can barely give them an hour a week. God says, I haven't come to make it harder. I've come to make it simpler. And then when we go to him, we get our sins dealt with. He conquered. He overcame them. We have forgiveness. We have death that's been defeated because he defeated death. And now life takes on a sudden clarity, doesn't it? Jesus, the God-man, He comes among us and he simplifies things, and Christ dwells in our hearts. And it's never too late. It wasn't too late for Abraham. He was pushing triple digits when God gave him his first child. And it wasn't too late for Moses. He had retired and God gave him his most fruitful experience in years, in his later years of life. It wasn't too late for Jonah. Jonah turned away from God, but God pulled him back. The stories in the Bible are filled with people who pushed their time limits, and God, for God, it was never too late. And now Jesus, he comes to us through his word and through his world and through his people who are called to be beacons in the world, you and I. He comes to us. The word becomes flesh. And he says, I want to work through you. And he does. And he will. And God, he continued to equip, empower, and embolden you to live a life where the word made flesh dwells and takes full possession of your heart. Remember, he's the Almighty God. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You know, when you hear about what God has done for us, sometimes the only thing we can do is just raise our hands and give him our adoration. So I'm going to ask, if you're comfortable with it, to please stand. We're going to be singing a song called The Door, and that's exactly what it is. You stepped down from heaven, you humbly came, the light of the world who came to save.
God of all creation.
In there as well. We'll do that now. The gift of new life, and that wonderful restored relationship with our Heavenly Father. I pray for blessings upon the church that are gathered around the living Word. I pray for those who proclaim the Word and teach it to us. I pray for missionaries who bring it to those who have not yet heard. I pray for families who impart this Word of faith to their children. I pray for parents who seek to exemplify the Word of God in their life through prayer, through attending the church, and through that wonderful witnessing that they can do for their children. I pray for peace in a world that just seems not to know what true peace is. Justice for the oppressed, protection for the weakest, especially the unborn. Punishment for the evildoers, Lord. And I ask that virtue and godly virtue would be promoted throughout our nation and really the nations of the world. As we know that body and blood is coming our way, I pray that our hearts would begin to prepare it to receive that which comes to us in bread and wine. I pray for the wounded in body or spirit, those who are grieving loved ones who have been lost, loved ones who are with the Lord, that have received their crown of eternal life. I
I thank you for that gift, and I pray for the oil of balm and the compassion and grace during our time of loss. I pray for strength for our church here at St. Peter's, and really your church throughout the world, that it would continue to grow and flourish and be bold to be the beacons in the communities that they're in, sharing the hope and love of Jesus. I thank you for those who've gone before us who have been witnesses. And I thank you for the time we have together, and later on for the fellowship that our congregation will enjoy. Finally, O Lord, I ask that you would help us, save us, defend us. For all the things you provide for us, we trust in your mercy. For the Word made flesh, O Lord Jesus Christ, to whom all glory and honor with the Father and the Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen.
There is part of coming up to receive the body and blood of Jesus that the Bible instructs us to do. One is to have faith and believe in the very presence of body and blood and our Lord and Savior Jesus. Another is to examine ourselves and to make sure that we're coming with a repentant heart, that we're not coming up here saying, I'm still going to keep on sinning on purpose, and yet I want this. We want to do this time of confession. So I move the confession to this part of our worship. And so I'm going to ask that you take some time for self-examination, and then I'm going to leave us all in a word of prayer. So as it says on your screen, recalling our sin and God's mercy, let us examine our lives and consciences. Father God, you sent your Son when the time was just right. And as we're about to experience on the night when he was betrayed, when he did, we come to you because we are poor sinners. And we're pleading just guilty before you, O Lord, for all of our sins. In fact, here our prayer as it comes from our minds to your hearts. I have lived as though you have not mattered, and that I matter most. Your name I have not honored, and my worship and prayers have altered me. I have not let your love have its way with me, and so my love for others has failed. There are those whom I have hurt, and those whom I have failed to help. My thoughts, my desires are soiled with sin. I am sorry for all my sins, and I plead for your mercy in Christ Jesus. Graciously forgive me of all my sins. Help me to amend my simple life. Amen. God, be merciful and strengthen your faith. In the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Peace of the Lord be with you all. Lord God, it is our joy and delight, our purpose and our duty to rejoice in the wonders of this day, the mystery of the Word made flesh, and the promise of glory that sin and death cannot overcome that. Give us this glory now and always as we may rejoice in the Word made flesh and what the Word made flesh has accomplished for us. We come to you and ask that we would come not only with repentant hearts, but our hearts ready to receive what comes to us in the bread and wine that is our body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. In the beginning, you created all things by your word. In the fullness of time, your word became flesh and dwelt among us also. So now your word made flesh will dwell with us as we ask that we would faithfully eat his body and blood. We would receive the fullness of your grace. Pray this in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he gave it thanks, he broke it. He gave it to his disciples and said, take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples and said, take and drink. This is the blood of the new covenant in my blood.
given and shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. We pray. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, giving us your body and blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember and confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
As you have prepared your hearts and minds, welcome to the Lord's Day.
He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing.
Thank you.
Almighty God, you poured into our hearts the true light of your incarnate word. Grant that this light may shine forth in our lives. Help us to keep our hearts faithful, that the joy of Christ's birth may sustain us through the journey of this life. And equip us as we preach and extend forgiveness. We know that life everlasting is ours. We have living in the world and not of it. Help us to shine forth that joy and that knowledge through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace.
Oh,
see you guys right after church. We've got our grill and barbecue going on there, and our collection of goods for those who are in need of Bible materials and other school materials. So have a great day. We'll see you over there. Ask me about the pastor who was fully robed and preached in bare feet. That's what I experienced when I was in Alliance.
Amen.